আমি করবো শিখতে পারি।
হ্যালো মনিকা, গুড আফটারনুন এভরিওয়ান।
গুড আফটারনুন।
সো দেয়ার্স আ রিকোয়েস্ট টু অল দ্য পার্টিসিপেন্টস টু প্লিজ মিউট দেয়ার মাইক্রোফোনস এন্ড টার্ন অফ দেয়ার ভিডিওস। দিস উইল হেল্প ইউ ইন কনজামিং ইউর ইন্টারনেট এন্ড ইউ নো ওয়াচিং দ্য ওয়েবিনার অ্যাট লিজ টুডে। এজ আ স্পিকার উই হ্যাভ ডক্টর মনিকা কল অ্যান্ড উই হ্যাভ ডক্টর সুলতান ইসমাইল। They both of them do not need an introduction. Dr. Monica Kaul, she's an expert into plant science and environment science, as well as Dr. Ismail sir, he's a ecobiologist and have a vast experience in environment science. May I request Monica ma'am to please initiate. Ma'am, your mic is on mute. If you can please turn it on. Unmuted, please. Right.
Fine. So, am I audible, Shreya?
Yes, ma'am, you are audible.
So I thank the IRS organizers for giving me this opportunity again to come and talk to the students and share our viewpoint on what we look for in the projects at IRIS. As we are all aware that this is the third one in the series. Our series was started by Professor Sultan Ismail, who is also the chairman of our entire program, and he's already talked about the animal sciences to you. In the second stint, we talked about the plant sciences and what kind of projects the judges look forward to in the category of plant sciences and what are good projects in plant sciences. And we discussed about how many opportunities we have there in the field. Today, I would just give you a brief on the kind of projects we expect from the students in the environmental sciences and earth sciences category. So as we all know, you know, environmental sciences is an interdisciplinary science. There is a lot you can do in environmental sciences. The category is so vast that you know, if you look into the aspects, any aspect of environment, and you know, environment comprises of our abiotic as well as biotic environment. So the various kinds of categories which you can look to in the environmental sciences includes, as I said, pollution. So one can look into the attributes, what are the causes of the water pollution, air pollution, noise pollution, soil pollution. And also in the project category, what are the reasons? Once you know the reasons, you also can look for the cure. You can look for the remedies of controlling these kinds of pollution. So our students who have participated in the projects, they have really done a lot in these fields, and their projects won prizes. For example, you know, they developed techniques which were eco-friendly. For example, they developed materials. Which were eco-friendly materials. Some of them, you know, developed kind of bricks for the making houses in areas which are more prone to earthquakes. They also developed various kinds of fabrics, fibers, materials which are more eco-friendly and which are more environmental friendly. Besides that, they also developed lots of materials. So what I'm trying to do is that in the environmental sciences category, we expect projects in the field of related to pollution, remediation, causes, wildlife. one of our students, you know, who won the prize, he developed a map and an app to identify the reasons why rhinoceros are getting extinct in the wild in Assam. Waste management is one big area where environmental science projects have been received by IRIS, and some of the projects really went ahead and represented India. So the method to decompose plastic waste, the novel innovative methods to degrade the polythenes, the various other mechanisms which are more eco-friendly, environmental friendly, monitoring aspects. We can take projects which can help us control and monitor the quality of various parameters in the water. So if any of you can blend technology with the basic sciences, one can look at developing monitoring tools, monitoring methodologies for the various kinds of the projects. Then, you know, environmental friendly pesticides and herbicides. You know, this is another way, because pesticides and herbicides are causing a lot of pollution. I'm sure Ismail sir has a lot of knowledge on this field. So some of our students did venture into developing certain techniques of developing some pesticides, methodology which can help us eradicate the pest problem, storage pest problem. Conservation aspects can be another aspect of the environmental sciences, conserving pollinators, conserving better, saving pollinators, and only killing pests. Some innovative stuff that can come into your mind. So, many of the projects which I have just discussed, last year we had a project wherein a student developed a methodology which is a source-to-end methodology in Bihar, where he used even computers and various other software technologies to develop tools of managing the waste and developing a well-developed platform. He gave a strategy to the municipal corporation there. So you can blend, because I said already that it's an interdisciplinary science. So here you don't have to be confined to a boundary. You can go look into various aspects, use microbes, use earthworms, as Ismail sir said, mollusks, various other kinds of stuff which can help in monitoring or helping us combat certain environmental problems. Is that the other aspect which we want to deal today is the earth sciences, another very important category. And I must tell you that earth sciences is now highly technology driven. So the kind of projects we get in earth sciences category has a lot of computer simulations, has a lot of programming involved. So any of you who likes geography along with computer science can think of certain projects. Like we had a student who developed a software to find out early alarming signals of a earthquake. So, and that project won an award. So geohazards, for example, there are lots of natural disasters which come in. So anything which can help us reduce the harmful effects of geohazards, that can translate into a good project. As I said, one can venture into hydrological studies, which is also a component of earth sciences. Look at how the currents, study the rate of the currents, study what happens during when there is a cyclone. You know, so many aspects. Climate data analysis is another thing. You know, that can also fit into the earth sciences category. I must tell you that we don't get very, large number of projects in earth sciences, because students are mainly focusing on plant sciences, animal sciences, and computers. But earth sciences is a category where we look for some good projects. So, example, quantifying the climatic data, looking and analyzing at the climatic data, because that can give you some aspects and you can relate it to what will happen to the crop species in the future, develop models related to climate, weather patterns, precipitation patterns, and for that the data is already available on the meteorological sites. What you can do is analyze that data, use some artificial intelligence tools, or use some software programs to interpret the data and develop climate models. So biogeochemical cycling is something, you know, which can be interpreted, and also you can look at what are the various factors which are affecting the water cycles in different areas. They can be region specific projects, because everywhere you have different kinds of climatic conditions, topographical conditions. So I mean, even in the category of earth sciences, people can look at those who are living near the coastlines. They can look on certain changes in the marine geochemistry, for example, water can analyze certain ions. Various things can be geobiology, the earth sciences. You can pick up the water samples near the coastline and look at what is there in them. Maybe you find some new organism. Maybe you find some groups of organisms which are peculiar of that region, which can act as indicators. So what I am trying to say here is that the category of environmental sciences and earth sciences is a vast category, and it is, you know, I just gave you certain domains, certain areas where you can look at. As I just said, you can look at the environmental friendly materials, for example, you also have to look at the cost benefit ratio. Maybe you develop some environmental friendly material which can be now used in green roofing or green biotech, what we call as, that can also fit into the environmental science category. So it is very important that first of all we identify our research question or identify our problem, and once we have identified our problem and understood our relationship with that problem, then we can think of developing a solution. You know, when you are submitting your project idea, it's not necessary that you have completed the entire project, but the idea which you are putting forward, you should have some sound knowledge and the background knowledge about what you are planning to do. So these are two key areas where we are looking for the projects in the domain of environmental sciences and the earth sciences. I must tell you, you're free to choose. You know, IRIS doesn't want to restrict your thinking abilities, or we don't want to keep you attached to us, attached to silos, or you don't want to be compartmentalized. You think broadly, and if you have good idea, you develop a research question. Put up a hypothesis. Do background research. For this, you will have to Google out all sources. Innovation is something which IRIS looks for. You should have a methodology in place. If you're writing a program, we should have access to what program you have used for modeling. We should know lots of what work you have undertaken, what controls you have used, and have you really followed a scientific method? So scientific method calls for experimentation. It calls for using a good methodology, which is standard methodology, and we want to see the data. Data can be quantitative, data can be qualitative. So you can support your data in the form of tables, graphs, pictures, diagrams, computer simulations. But there has to be some quantitative or qualitative data to support what you're doing, where you did. I'm sure Ismail sir will tell you about the ethics when we are talking about doing projects related to organisms. There we have to follow certain ethics. So maybe Ismail sir also wants to join in. I don't want to take the entire time because Ismail sir is here. We must listen to him. He's our guide, of course. Is Ismail sir here?
Yeah, yeah.
Hello. Ismail sir, you want to say something?
Yeah, I'll just add up a few more things after what you have said. A few more things which they can think about. Thanks, Monica, for joining us today and sharing a lot of information which you have been able to do. Thanks to Sharon, Shrey, Ishita, Shasha, and all those people who are associated with this. Children, what I would like to tell you is, please take what Monica said very beautifully. Apart from that, you can also think in other terms, we call it as bioremediation, because environmental management and environmental science requires this term bioremediation. Today, it's very, very important. You have heard that even a Nobel Prize was won for microbe which can remove oil and convert oil into carbon dioxide and water. So there's a wide scope in this particular field of bioremediation. You can think about bioremediation. And one more thing which I have always felt is, deliberately I wanted to join today, even though I have spoken to you about animal sciences last visit, is these two subjects cannot be separated. Botany and zoology can never be separated. They are natural sciences. We call it as biological sciences or natural sciences. The one thing which I want you people to understand is whether you can work on plant-animal interactions. Children, I'll give you one beautiful example. Dodo is a bird which is extinct. When dodo went extinct, nobody knew. They thought that dodo is extinct. But much later, they could not locate or see trees like Calvaria major growing. Calvaria major does not grow because unless a dodo eats the fruit and sends it through its excreta, it cannot germinate. This is called as plant-animal interaction. In olden days, they used to use ducks in paddy cultivation to suppress weeds. So if you can think about something unique on plant-animal interactions, that would be wonderful. It can also be with reference to pollinators, because pollinators are now becoming extinct. What are the alternative pollinators? Honeybees, wasps, bumblebees. There are lots of things which you can work on. But please remember that the trend today is to work on zoonoses, zoonotic diseases. Because of deforestation, most of the microorganisms, especially virus, bacteria, who were already pests on other mammals, find man or human beings as interesting. So because the bigger mammals are not available, they're trying to hop on to other. In fact, the COVID-19 is one of the specific cases that it moved from chiropterans to human beings, homo sapiens. So please remember all this. There are other practical problems in environmental management. The whole world is looking at RO water today for drinking, but they do not know what to do with the water which comes out from the RO plant, which is not consumable or potable. You take only 20-25%, maximum 30% of water for drinking. The remaining 70% of the water is getting wasted. Can you come out with a solution? Think about it. Erosion, soil erosion is a massive thing today. Topsoil. Nature takes at an average 250 to 400 years to develop 1 inch of topsoil. And we are losing topsoil. Can you come out with a mechanism? Can you think about conservation of topsoil or a formation of topsoil? Think about it. Locust attacks, which are happening today. Do you think? People say, why not we make pheromone traps? You cannot make pheromone traps for locusts because they already have enough partners with them. They need not go in search of a female. So pheromone traps don't work out. Can you work out of some other frequencies like light frequency traps or sound frequency traps? That would be a mind-blowing thing for you to get. I would say that you definitely get a grand award if you can make that sort of a trap, right? Fly ash is a big nuisance in every developed city. Fly ash comes from this power generation plants by burning coal. It's a big problem because it also has heavy metals in it. You children immediately think of making a brick out of it. Brick cannot be made out of it. You can use it as part of the cement. Yes, but many cement factories are not interested in it. Can you come out with an alternative? Start thinking about it. Please also concentrate on the geographic region. That's Indian Ocean Dipole. Please remember this term, Indian Ocean Dipole. Now, this probably has been one of the causes for the locust attacks, for the unwanted rains which happened in the northern horn of the East Africa. So please think whether you can work on this Indian Ocean Dipole. And water and soil management relationships have never been worked out. We work water management separate, soil management separate. Can you come out with something with that? Because that can be related with the SRI pattern of paddy agriculture. SRI is system of rice intensification. If you can think something like that one, which is also called as the Madagascar method. If you can come with a variation for our India and call it as the Indian method, for SRI, that would be a great thing. You can also think about one more very important problem which we are all facing is prosopis. Prosopis, even though it's contributing something good for us, but many people are planning to remove it, it becomes a manual labor. Can you come out with some mechanism of a competitive plant? Think about competitive plants, think about combination plants, think about how to grow plants in association with others like multi-cropping, which can decrease pest attacks, all these components. But let it be innovative, let it be unique, let it be new, and that you come out with something with your passion and say, this is my work. Is that clear? And good luck. We'll be continuing our discussion.
So if you have any questions, please feel free to ask the speakers right now. Reason being, we don't have that much of time on this webinar. So if you would like to ask a question, please type it in the chat section. Please make use of the fact that our experts are here to answer your questions. Thank you.
Pin Monica. Monica, open your mic because you'll have to speak now.
Am I audible?
You are audible now. I want Monica to be highlighted. Pin her also. You open your mic. It's again gone into off. Monica. और आपको पिन कर दिया जाए.
सर मैं ऑडिबल हूँ.
हाँ.
यस मैम यू आर ऑडिबल.
यू आर ऑडिबल.
Smile sir, I would like to request you to explain our participants on the new subject categories we have. Since this year we have added in certain categories, for example, biomedical and health sciences, yeah, biomedical engineering, computational biology. Yeah, they are highlighted in gray. There are few categories which like computer science, which has been divided into three subcategories, which are embedded systems, robotics, intelligent machines, and system softwares. Whereas the medicine and other categories has been divided into categories, as I mentioned, computational biology, bioinformatics, biomedical engineering, biomedical health sciences, translation, medical and sciences. So, sir, if you can, throw some light on how few of or some of these categories can be connected to environment science and what kind of projects they can relate to if they are working on something which is in environment science as well as, let's say, biomedical engineering.
For example, among the new subjects, biomedical and health sciences, that's what Monica was talking about. Right. Because the plant sources of India with our rich biodiversity. I would appreciate if children can access National Bureau of Plant Genetic Resources, their data, and find out as to what are, can be suitable plants, which could be a very rich resource for our health sciences. That could be a good sort of a beginning in biomedical and health sciences. And in fact, they can go in for lots of computational of things as well over there, which also includes biomedical engineering is a very, very upgrowing subject today. Most of the technology institutions have introduced this new subject called as biomedical research or medical engineering research. Here you find that you can even design tools that could be used in medicine. It is something which is different from medical. It is almost engineering related to medical institutions where children work on certain instrumentations and things which could be useful in...
spectrophotometer or something like a handy microscope which can be used by students where they don't have access to microscope, spectrophotometers, some kind of colorimeters. There is so much where what you can do in biomedical sciences or develop testing kits. For example, last time we had a student who developed he had come up with an idea of test paper. He used a litmus paper, but then he made a small device to find out that estrus cycle in the cattle. So he developed a colorimetric based tool, a small gadget where we could test using spectral analysis. So I think, sir, in biomedical sciences, we can have such kind of tools. The last year's project was somewhat related to biomedical sciences. We also had that urine testing kit to know whether a person has a cervical cancer or not. That is a part of biomedical sciences. So many of the previous year students had done some things related to biomedical sciences or devices. For example, sir, that early warning of a cardiac attack. That student is now a TED speaker. He developed that gadget to let people know of the heart attack syndrome, symptoms. So there are many things which you can blend the knowledge of various domains and reach at some solution which is practical, which is viable, and which is not very costly. That can be a part of biomedical sciences. And some of the projects in the previous years have won awards.
Monica, you should emphasize on translation and medical sciences, which is a new branch, and it's more amount of bioinformatics and biotechnology related. That would be more inclusive. Yeah, it would be wonderful for children.
As we can see, sir, there are two categories. One is the computational biology and bioinformatics. Computational biology in itself has a word called biology, which can be, you can say that it's a plant science. So how it is different from plant sciences and computational biology? How students can differ their project into two of these categories?
It so happened long back that people started working even with me. Develop softwares and mechanisms, and in computational biology becomes very essential in classification as well as in the case of drug delivery and all patterns. So bioinformatics usually gets related with drug delivery. People can generate new medicines. They can go in for that and apply computational biology to understand the nuances of bioinformatics and drug development and delivery. So it comes into that. It can source from both plant and animal sciences. It involves all branches of biology. So it's botany per se is plant sciences. Zoology per se becomes animal sciences, where veterinary also goes in. Computational biology and bioinformatics encompasses biochemistry, microbiology, botany, zoology, biotechnology. And translational medical goes into medicine, biotechnology, genetic engineering, botany, and zoology. So the chances are, there may be some overlap, but depending upon where these children have emphasized more in their research, they could be asked to submit in that particular branch. That's the only thing we can
right.
See, another thing is...
So there is a question, ma'am. There is a question from a participant regards synopsis presentation. What are the strategies a participant should find in synopsis presentation?
Monica, explain, I think please.
Yeah.
Children, if you want me to tell you in just one word, in synopsis should be a gist of your passion in just 250 words. It should highlight your passion as to what you want to do, your objective, your hypothesis, if you have already done some methodology briefly about it and what you would like to apply, and if you already got some results to mention about that as well. That will influence us to decide. At the same time, let me be very clear that the work you are talking about should not be known to Google Uncle. If Google Uncle already says that this exists, then probably we'll have to tell you, we are sorry. So you must be something unique. You should be something different, not what somebody else has done. This is not an exhibition, this is a national fair. Children, please understand that concept. Monica, please add up, Monica. Your mic is off.
Okay. As Sultan sir has already pointed out that synopsis is your passion. Actually, when you have ideas, we are aware about it. And you already are working on certain projects. You have decided to work on certain projects. Maybe you have been working on some things and you want to take it forward and participate. We don't know you. You don't know the judges, right? So Synopsis is an interface between you and the team of judges which sits there. And they are there to take best out of so many projects and so many schools who apply. The judges are assigned with this responsibility of looking at these synopses and on the basis of the synopsis decide whether you would be invited to participate in an annual fair or not. So the synopsis has actually speak in terms of what you have written. It has to be crystal clear. As Sultan sir pointed out, the project has to be innovative. So people will Google out whether this has been worked or not. And if it is already worked on, it's out. But it should give you, when you are writing a synopsis, the language should be clear. You don't have to use very flowery language, simple language. And this, the main things which should be addressed in the synopsis, as Sultan sir pointed out, we should have one or two lines on introduction. The idea should come out very clearly through the title. So title itself has to be, innovative in the sense that it should tell, it should make us read the entire project. So the problem which we are looking at should be addressed. Proposed work done, or you might have done the work, or you may be doing some of the work. In two or three sentences, you also have to give us that. And also, if you have any model already available, you can send it as a supplementary as well, or any proposed figure or any proposed diagram, whatever I mean. So we should be able to understand what is the research, what is the novelty, and what methodology you have used with the conclusion which you have achieved or which you seek to achieve. So that gives us an idea that you have followed the scientific method as well. So please try to give the information in a clear, crystal, easily comprehensible language. And anything which you feel you want to add besides these, because the limited words are there, you can give as a supplementary file. Sir, Sultan, sir.
Yeah, no, more than that, one pertinent question has come from one Mr. Tanur Singh, that what solution do you give to participants who lack access to labs and chemicals? At this point of time, we do appreciate and understand that due to this present crisis, you have this limitation, but nothing prevents you to put forth your thoughts of innovation, which you already have in mind. So please try to put in and what methodology you would like to apply and what is your innovation component in it. We'll definitely take these things into consideration because if this thing continues, we'll be doing it online and we can understand the limitations. So please proceed and please
and
do it.
Sir,
it's not essential, yeah.
And sir, can I?
Yeah.
So to add to it, I would say that, see, the wet experiments are needed in certain kinds of projects, but not every project would need you to do wet experiments. And some of the experiments can be done in the pots if you have that amount of space or if you're doing something bioassay kind of a thing. But if you're trying to figure out things in bioinformatics category or in categories of, as I said, earth sciences, environment, and in many aspects of environmental sciences, you can right now do a lot of work because there are lots of databases where you can access data and do in silico studies. Some of the in silico studies can also be done. Have we addressed the question?
Yeah, yeah, I think we have, but Shrey,
yes, I think so.
First slide again, and
So the first slide is the one that talked about the synopsis, but before that, I think we have a video which will explain a lot of things to everybody. So we will have the video coming up now. Please take a look. There are a lot of things which will be made clear when you see that. And then once the video gets over, we can take a couple of questions more.
Yeah, absolutely fine. We can discuss some more things if we have time.
While we're getting ready with the video, Dr. Ishmael, may I request you to please answer the questions which are there in the chat sections on the chat itself, please?
I have been replying there. Some of them I have replied.
Yes, sir. I know. There is some. There's a question now. The last query. Yeah.
It's...
Does the project decide on the quality of material used? Sir?
I don't understand what is material.
Are you ready for the ride of your life? Well, it all begins right here. Your first step is picking a category you can enter by yourself or with a partner. If you're in 5th to 8th standard, you will be in junior category. If you're in 9th to 12th, you're in senior category and have a chance of making it all the way to ISEF. Now that you know which category you are in, it is time to find out which subject your project comes under.
At IRIS, you have a variety of 21 subject categories to choose from, ensuring that your project has a category that fits. The categories include Animal Sciences, Behavioral and Social Sciences, Biochemistry, Biomedical and Health Sciences, Biomedical Engineering, Cellular and Molecular Biology, Chemistry, Computational Biology and Bioinformatics, Earth and Environmental Sciences, Embedded Systems, Energy, Sustainable Materials and Design, Engineering Mechanics, Environmental Engineering, Material Sciences, Mathematics, Microbiology, Physics and Astronomy, Plant Sciences, Robotics and Intelligent Machines, System Software, and Transitional Medical Sciences.
A display shows the public and the judges what you've done. You're looking to attract and inform visitors about your project. To make it easy for people to access your results by creating a clear, attractive and concise display. The focus should be the work. Take a look at this reference. Your title should be simple and must accurately represent your research. Take photographs or videos of important parts or phases of your experiment to use in your display. Prepare a miniature of your model in case your prototype is too large to be carried along. Make sure your display is logically presented and easy to read. Use neat, colorful headings, charts, and graphs to present your project. Pay special attention to labeling. Be sure to adhere to the size limitations, safety rules when preparing your display.
The IRIS journey begins with registration on the website www.irisnationalfair.org with submission of online synopsis and supporting documents. These entries are prejudged by the IRIS Scientific Review Committee, and shortlisted projects are sent an email inviting them to participate in the IRIS National Science Fair. Winners of the IRIS National Science Fair qualify for an intensive series of mentoring camps and get the opportunity to represent India at platforms such as the Regeneron International Science and Engineering Fair in the United States of America. ICEF is the world's largest pre-college STEM competition. Over 265 Indian students have won over 160 awards at this competition, competing with over 6 million high school students from all over the world each year. Not only are you getting a chance to make your nation proud, but if you're lucky, you could join the 31 Indian students who have had minor planets named after them.
So guys, please don't miss this opportunity.
It's your turn now.
If you're innovative and you really want to bring about a change in the world, I think IRIS is the right.
You enjoy science and math and computer science and so on. So, I mean, it gives you a platform to show what you've done, and you have a chance to go to ISCF too.
If science actually kindles your curiosity and you're really passionate about it, IRIS provides you the largest platform in India to show your talent.
Applying to IRIS, not only get to have a great experience, you meet great people. And great mentors are that. They're not judges. They're not judging you. They're mentoring you. They're teaching you. They make you learn new things.
In the end, it's not about winning or losing. It's about experience. And IRIS National Fair guarantees great experience. Don't tell people what your dreams are. Show what your dreams are through IRIS.
It's once in a lifetime experience.
It's your turn.
It's your turn. It's your turn.
It's your turn. It's your turn.
It's your turn.
Why am I pinned up over here? Anyway, children, there are some questions which have come in after that, saying that what should we be writing? Should there be actual experiments to be done? It depends on the category you choose. Like in the case of mathematics, you will be having only paperwork, which can be creative, which you are able to do, or you can even design models. If you're going to do something on chemistry, it cannot be just based on reactions until you prove them. Bioremediation cannot be done just on paper unless you prove them. Reputation cannot be built based on what you have in mind unless you prove it. My voice is not audible. It's impossible. My voice should be audible. Is my voice audible?
Shrey? Audible, sir. Yeah.
Mera awaaz nahi sunayega to phir kiska awaaz sunayega yaar? Theek hai? Yeah. So children, you will have to plan accordingly. You will have to plan where experiments are required. Yes, experiments do it. It is not that you must do an experiment. Where it is required, yes, experiments we expect. Because we need evidence, we need proof, we need innovation. Only based on evidences, we can forward. Children, understand that we get almost nearly 2,000 applications in the course of time. And we have a very tough task of selecting the most innovative projects. And totally put together, we have to select about 70. You can imagine the task that we have to put in based on innovation. Because once we sit, it is not you or I, it is Team India. And Team India has to succeed at ISCF. That is the only ambition. And for that, you have to be innovative. And we are always with you. Monica? Monica, ma'am,
yeah. Please add, because we will be concluding in the next 5 minutes. So before that, I would like you to continue talking, but I'd also like to thank both you and Ismail, sir. But please continue. The webinar may stop in another 5 minutes.
As Sultan sir pointed out, I could see some of the questions here. One question was, what material are we judged on the based on the material? See, students, it's very important for you to understand that we are not judging your artistic skills, which material you are using. This is a science-based project. you know, fair, where, for example, you can't bring in anything if you have done a field experiment. There you have to bring in photographs and the data which you have observed during the field visits or during the experimentation. You have conducted pot experiments and tested, for example, you wanted to test some material is helping growth or flowering or fruiting. You're not going to get the entire pots along. There you will have to have, from your data, we understand from your data that you have conducted experiments. So your data should have quantitative and supportive photographs to show that you conducted the experiments. Everything cannot be carried to a science fair. Only a prototype, if you have designed some machine, a working system, that you can bring along. And which materials you have used, what materials you have used, that is irrespective of the material. What we look at is what is the science behind working of that machine, or what is the science behind working of that model or a robo as well. So what is important for you to understand is that the scientific principle, you have to give in synopsis as a supplementary file. The you may even give a ray diagram if it is a spectrophotometer which you have devised. You may give a diagram of electronic machine. You can give a transistor type or whatever you have used. You have to give and bring along something which tells us that you're working on this project and the project has a scientific basis. So I think I have made it clear that material is irrespective of what you give. Another thing which I want to address here is some of the students are saying that various other questions like what should be, what kind of project get prizes. We don't know, right? We don't know. What it is always that something interesting comes in and students have ideas, and we then when they bring those ideas on a platform as a synopsis, we understand that there is some potential in it. Then they come to the national fair, the teachers help out. It's very important that you should have some mentor to support you always. That mentor can be your teacher.